Tonight, with a leaked SHA memo in hand, the opposition is accusing the provincial government of muzzling healthcare workers. Also, the family of a woman who died after a fight in a Saskatoon nightclub wants accountability after charges were stayed last week.
To have all charges dropped was completely, like, absolutely shocking to myself and to my family, so.
Plus, growing the game. Young players celebrate as Hockey Saskatchewan gets ready to launch its new Women's Junior Hockey League.
It's honestly...
This is CBC Saskatchewan News.
It is Tuesday, April 18th, and the CBC Saskatchewan News starts right now. Good evening and thank you for watching. The Opposition NDP says an internal memo it obtained from the Saskatchewan Health Authority is evidence workers are being muzzled by the government. The health minister says the NDP are torquing the content of the memo. Adam Hunter has the details.
The NDP says a memo issued by the SHA on February 7th is an attempt to silence healthcare workers by the government. That day, two NDP MLAs were in the community of Lanigan. They did not make a formal request to tour the hospital. They did, however, plan to speak with healthcare workers.
While we were meeting with municipal leaders and healthcare workers off-site, a confidential hush memo was issued to employees of the Lanigan Hospital. The hush memo stated that hospital employees were forbidden from answering questions or providing any information to opposition MLAs.
Mo would suggest the memo was issued at the direction of the government, but she did not provide any evidence of that. She and other NDP MLAs traveled around the province earlier this year and toured several health facilities. They say they were accompanied by Sask Party MLAs and staffers. In question period, the health minister shot back at the allegations of muzzling healthcare workers with the memo.
They're taking everything and they're multiplying it by 10, Mr. Speaker. It is absolutely ridiculous. I met with two doctors yesterday. I'm meeting with another doctor later on this afternoon. I'm meeting with nine nurses later on this week. We are sitting down at the tables in the coffee rooms of the healthcare facilities. We're talking to nurses. We're engaging with them virtually. Well, they certainly had no problem talking to you and all the other tours you went to, didn't they? Didn't it?
Merriman says the government is not silencing anyone.
We have never, ever muzzled healthcare workers, Mr. Speaker. We will not do that. Health workers are very open and engaging with us, sometimes brutally honestly, Mr. Speaker, and that's okay.
Merriman says the memo in question is part of the SHA's overall guidance to its staff and facilities and is sent out periodically. It is not meant in any way to interfere with any planned tours by the NDP. Mowat says the timing of the February 7th memo is highly suspicious. Adam Hunter, CBC News, Regina.
Saskatchewan's Minister of Agriculture is apologizing. He nominated someone who is guilty of domestic abuse for a Queen's Platinum Jubilee Medal. As Laura Sharpoletti reports, the minister says it wasn't appropriate.
Saskatchewan's Minister of Agriculture, David Merritt, says he only learned last week that a man he nominated for a Queen's Jubilee Medal had pled guilty to a domestic violence charge. That man is Jim Wickett, a former chairman of the Western Canadian Wheat Growers Association. Merritt says he took immediate action after the province learned about the assault, and Wickett was asked to return the medal. He has done so. Wickett was awarded the medal in December. Merritt says he made his nominations for the Jubilee Medal based on recommendations from the Ministry of Agriculture. He said he was not aware of the criminal charges, and he says he would have never nominated Wickett had he known about the assault.
It's very difficult. Obviously, you know, you put names forward to people that you feel are, you know, deserving of an award, and when something like this happens, it tugs at your heart.
Merritt says it is not okay to give a person convicted of such a crime an honor like the Jubilee Medal.
Very apologetic to, you know, victims and survivors of domestic abuse, and it has no place in society.
Merritt's apology comes about 6 months after the government issued a different apology for inviting convicted wife killer Colin Thatcher to the throne speech.
We just continue to see a bit of
a message from this government and a bit of a pattern that's emerging from this government where they seem to not be taking seriously what kind of a message it sends to the people of the province when people who abuse women are honored by this government.
Merritt says some sort of vetting process for future Jubilee Medal recipients might be appropriate, but given that there were 7,000 recipients last year, it may prove to be logistically difficult. Laura Sharpaletti, CBC News, Regina.
The family of Hodan Hashi wants accountability. Hashi died after a fight with another woman inside a Saskatoon nightclub last November. The manslaughter charge against the other woman was stayed last week. The defense team maintains she acted in self-defense. But as Avanthika Anand reports, Hashi's sister says the legal system failed to deliver justice.
To have all charges dropped was completely, like, absolutely shocking to myself and to my family. So that's something that was way beyond anything that we would have ever imagined to happen.
Shukri Hashi remembers being speechless when a Crown attorney called to tell her that the woman who'd been accused in her sister's death would not face a trial.
And we were just so upset. Like, I actually don't even remember. I feel like we blacked out. We didn't even know what to say. We asked her why. Obviously, everything that they've released, information about them saying it was accidental and it had a low likelihood of it being convicted in trial.
Hodan Hashi died after an altercation with another woman at a Saskatoon nightclub in November. Video of the incident was circulated widely online, and 22-year-old Paige Therio Fisher was initially charged with first-degree murder, then downgraded to manslaughter. Last week, that charge was stayed.
This was never meant to happen, and if I could give everything back, I would take that day back. And I really do wish Hodan was with us today.
The Crown called the fight mutual, said no weapons were used, and that Hashi fell on broken glass. Shukri believes race played a role in that decision. Her sister was black, while the accused is white.
There's no way that someone like my sister or any person of color would have walked away with zero consequences for their actions that night if the roles were reversed. So I think in anything in life, race does play a role, and I do believe it did in this case.
We've seen time and time again how this legal system continues to protect white people at all costs, and sometimes that cost is black people.
Shukri says the family now plans to hire a private investigator to gather new evidence with the hopes of reopening the case.
We understand that it's going to be a complicated and lengthy fight. We're just not going to stop until we have some sort of resolution towards this.
Supporters of Hashi's family are now planning protests in Ottawa, Regina, and Saskatoon for April 29th. Avanthika Anand, CBC News, Ottawa.
The Public Service Alliance of Canada says its members are prepared to hit the picket lines if they don't have an agreement by 9 o'clock tonight Eastern. The union represents more than 155,000 federal public servants, including Canada Revenue Agency employees. Kate McKenna has the latest.
The clock is ticking. Still no deal.
I know that we're working very hard on the current negotiations. We have a competitive and fair wage on the table, and also that is reasonable to Canadians. Therefore, we're going to continue to work hard until we get to a deal.
The Canada's largest federal public service union gave Ottawa an ultimatum. If there's no plan by 9 p.m. Eastern time, they strike. They've already set up toilets and offices in downtown Ottawa.
If there is a public service strike, there would be a serious impact on any departments that have staff who've been impacted. We know that processing delays are the kind of thing that could take place.
If workers strike, Canadians can expect longer waits, processing paperwork like taxes and employment insurance, also at airports and crossing land borders.
Strikes are very uncomfortable. Withdrawing your labor and not getting a paycheck is uncomfortable. Walking through picket lines is uncomfortable. The whole purpose is the union trying to make the employer uncomfortable.
The main sticking point is wages. The union wants a 13.5% increase over 3 years. So far, the government is only offering 9%. PSAC also wants rules about working from home enshrined in the collective agreement.
When the federal government represses its wages for its own employees, what they're doing is repressing wages for workers right across the country.
The union says it wants to use its size to pressure the government into making a precedent-setting deal. If it does go on strike later tonight, it'll be its largest strike since 1991. Kate McKenna, CBC News, Ottawa.
A strike could be coming to WestJet. Roughly 1,800 pilots at the airline have voted overwhelmingly in support of taking job action next month if necessary. As Brian Labby reports, their union is hoping it will push WestJet to negotiate a new contract.
This is showing the pilot group's unity and how resolved they are to get a contract that we need.
That's Bernard Lewell, a captain with WestJet and a spokesperson for the pilots' union. He says the pilots want a fair North American standard contract.
The North American standards are actually about 50% higher than what we're currently being compensated for. So there's a huge differential. We think that gap has to narrow.
John Craddock is an aviation analyst at McGill University in Montreal.
WestJet will blink first. They can't afford to have this thing shut down.
Craddock says the pilots appear to be in a strong negotiating position.
The big issue with pilots these days is that we're short. You know, in Canada, we're short about 5,000 pilots. In the U.S., they're short about 30,000 pilots. So pilots are a very endangered species.
In a statement, WestJet says strike authorization doesn't mean a strike will occur and that it's, quote, unwaveringly committed to achieving an agreement with its pilots that is competitive within Canada's airline industry and ensures the airline has a long-term sustainable future. The earliest the pilots could strike is May 16th, just days before the Victoria Day long weekend. Brian Labby, CBC News, Calgary.
That significant spring storm we talked about yesterday is indeed making its way into Saskatchewan tonight. Winter storm warnings blanket the southeast corner of the province, and snowfall warnings are in place for the southwest, as well as Regina and Yorkton. As this mess of precipitation moves into the province, CAA is reminding drivers to be prepared.
Make sure that you have your winter emergency kit still in your car. Make sure that you have water, some maybe protein bars, chocolate. You're going to want blankets, extra clothing. All those layers, they really help. I mean, a lot of us have taken our mitts and ski pants and boots out of the car. Make sure they're back in the car for this storm. If you're going to head out, make sure that you have a full tank of gas and you have your cell phone that is charged. Make sure your charger is in the car. You may need it.
If you're out on the roads tonight, CAA is also reminding drivers to slow to 60 when passing tow trucks or other emergency vehicles and to keep an eye out for amber and blue flashing lights. A little time-lapse video from a little earlier this afternoon looking at the Broadway Bridge in Saskatoon. It's been a mix of rain and snow there today. And while Saskatoon may not be under a snowfall warning, some of that mixed rain and snow, it's still coming. What about the rest of the province over the next 24 hours or so? Ethan will have the full forecast after the break. Stay with us.
This weather update is brought to you by Capital GMC Buick Cadillac. Super Sierra and SUV sale is on now.
Welcome back. Our weather specialist, Ethan Williams, joins me now. And Ethan, that icky weather we had this morning was not actually the storm system that we're waiting for.
Yes, it's only just begun, Sam, really. We're seeing some snow across the province right now, but this is just a precursor, and we actually have upgraded weather warnings as of this point now in the province. We now have snowfall warnings from an area from Assiniboia-Gravelburg up toward Regina and Moose Jaw and northeast through Yorkton-Melville, the Kamsack-Kenora area, and now a winter storm warning for southeastern Saskatchewan. So what does this all mean? Well, if you're in the snowfall warning area, probably about 10 to 20 centimeters by the time tomorrow's over with, and some pretty strong wind gusts up to 50, maybe 60 kilometers an hour. And if you're in that winter storm warning in Estevan, Weyburn, Carlisle, Oxbow, northward toward Mooseman, Kipling, Wawota, anywhere between 15 and 40 centimeters, especially in the higher elevations, and some wind gusts could be close to 70 kilometers an hour. And again, this is the beginnings of the storm that we're seeing here. Some bands of snow moving up towards Saskatoon, pretty snowy there right now. We saw some move through Regina earlier, even a little bit of rain in southeastern Saskatchewan. But this is what we're keeping our eye on. This is eventually going to change to snow and move eastward. You can see through Wyoming and Montana right now. It's actually thunderstorms that we're seeing. And then as that hits that colder air, that's when we're going to see it change over to snow. Pretty gusty in advance of this as well. Some gusts close to 50 kilometers an hour in southeastern Saskatchewan this afternoon. Even in the north, you are feeling some effects from this. So here's how it all plays out. Again, the bands of snow you can see right now going to be continuing through the evening. Central Saskatchewan seeing some of that snow. Mixed precipitation changing over to snow as we head through the overnight hours. Again, especially in southeastern Saskatchewan, heaviest amounts there. The question is, we don't know quite how much snow there is because there's other low pressure systems around the main Colorado low, and that Colorado low could pull in some of that extra excess moisture from those systems as well. So that could bring some extra moisture. Keep in mind that through much of the rest of south and central Saskatchewan, you are still going to be seeing snow. So you won't be spared this if you're in places like Saskatoon or Swift Current. Even through the day Thursday, we could see measurable snowfall. So again, amounts could be between 10 and 20 in places like Regina, Assiniboia, Gravelburg, closer to 20 in the southeast. Add on a little bit more as we head through the day Thursday. But again, these amounts could be a little bit high, especially as it's wet snow and it could melt on contact. And again, it goes without saying that we could see some very strong wind gusts with this, very breezy through the night tonight and heading through the day tomorrow again between 50 and 70 in some spots. And that just keeps going as we head through Thursday as well. Probably going to be around Friday when we start to see winds diminish. And Friday is also when we're going to probably start to see some sunshine as well. But temperatures over these next couple of days, some 10 to 15 degrees below average for this time of year. And in Regina and the south, it's going to take us a while to kind of get back up into those more normal conditions. And those overnight lows, as you can see, dropping down to around minus 12 Saturday. They should be around minus 1 this time of year. For Saskatoon, again, for you, I think probably in the 5 to 10 centimeter range tomorrow, but then the bulk of that snow is over with. Still going to be quite windy. Visibility probably going to be an issue. But then central Saskatchewan actually getting quite a nice warm-up, Sam. So maybe spring can actually get underway.
Yay for them.
Yeah, I'm jealous.
What a crappy forecast.
Thanks, Ethan. You're welcome.
Well, signs of spring are in overdrive elsewhere north of Los Angeles with a super bloom of golden poppies and wildflowers. An unusually wet winter set the stage for this stunning show in California's Antelope Valley. Carpets of breathtaking flowers so big and vibrant, they can even be seen from space. The area is a protected reserve showcasing about 700 hectares of the eye-popping state flower. We'll be back after the break. The inflation rate in Canada has slowed again. Stats Canada reports the consumer price index rose by 4.3% in March, down from 5.2% in February. Gas and groceries were key items again last month. The price at the pumps is down nearly 14% compared to March of last year. However, food price inflation remains stubbornly high despite a slight easing. Grocery cost increases slowed to 9.7% compared to nearly 11% in February. A major factor pushing up the cost of living? Mortgage interest. It's climbed more than 26% compared to a year ago. Canadian grocery giant Loblaw is getting new leadership. Galen Weston is stepping aside as president, but he's not getting out of the supermarket business entirely. Anise Haidari has the details.
We search the world for the best possible...
Galen Weston won't be making any more president's choices, so to speak.
What? Why?
The grocery executive is being replaced as Loblaw president, a European supermarket CEO coming to Canada to head up more than 2,400 stores and multiple brands. It's a leadership change as executives face questions about food prices.
Loblaw's is unique in the sense that Galen's such a public face of the company. So the targeted anger can be personified in an individual just like it can be with an Elon Musk. So that's what Galen Weston's become here in Canada, a lightning rod. The reason he's getting out of the kitchen or the grocery store for that matter is because the heat's too high.
Loblaw says the search for new leadership took months. Galen Weston has been president since 2021 when his predecessor retired.
Galen, I think, wisely stepped into the role, and I'm going to say I think he did a good job in those couple of years, but I'm sure he is thrilled to move back into invisibility and let someone else handle the day-to-day operations.
The company hasn't decided if invisibility means no more ads for Weston. Marketers say he may not be the guy to sell savings.
Galen just isn't the right person to be delivering that value message. So I also believe that the President's Choice brand and No Name brand now are brands in their own right. They don't really need Galen in order to flourish and to do well. And in fact, I think they will do better without him as the face.
Galen Weston isn't getting out of the grocery business. He'll remain chairman of the Loblaw Board of Directors, and he's still CEO of the parent company, George Weston Limited. So his financial ties remain deep and controlling when it comes to the supermarket. Anis Haidari, CBC News, Calgary.
And Ethan is back with one last look at your weather.
And snow beginning tonight in southern Saskatchewan will be at the 1 degree mark. Still going to be breezy in Regina overnight tonight with gusts close to 50 kilometers an hour, similar to what we saw last night. That blowing snow really taking over, though, by the morning hours. And those northeast winds could be between 60 and 70, will be around minus one. And then actually our temperature going to be dropping as we head through the morning and afternoon in Regina, landing around minus two or so, but still going to be seeing quite a bit of snow and reduced visibility. Saskatoon, you're going to escape the worst of this, I think, but you're still going to be seeing flurries and strong winds overnight and into tomorrow morning. Still going to be seeing flurries by the morning hour, but you will warm up to around freezing. Still some light snow, pretty breezy. Good day to just stay home and off the road, Sam.
All right. Thanks, Ethan.
You bet.
And before we leave you, while the NHL playoffs are getting underway, hockey season across the province is coming to a close, and thoughts are turning to next season. It'll be a big one for young women in Saskatchewan. As Dan Plaster reports, players say a new five-team junior league will fuel the growth of women's hockey.
This is what young girls who love the game can aspire to. But unless a player has been recruited by a university, their playing career usually ends at the age of 17. But now, these girls will have another option. Saskatchewan is creating a U22 female hockey league, also known as Junior Women's.
It's honestly awesome to see. Just the sport is growing so much.
Sage Babby has already signed with an American college, but still applauds the new league.
It's so cool how you can just stay in like your province with the junior league now. Like you can, if you're unsure of what university you want to go to, you can just play another year at home, stay with your family.
The new junior league will have teams in Regina, Lumsden, Kindersley, Outlook, and in the Southwest, represented by Swift Current and Gull Lake. Now there's already a U18 AAA league in Saskatchewan, and this builds on that.
It's definitely overdue, and really looking forward to the girls' sake that they get to participate in something like that, because junior hockey in our province is very long tradition on the male side, and this will be awesome for the girls to jump in at the ground floor to build their own tradition.
U18 Team Saskatchewan head coach Robin Ulrich sees a giant opportunity, and not just for the players.
It's just another level of competitive female hockey that hopefully we can start to graduate some female coaches into that level and just create more and more opportunities for female coaches to coach and to work at a higher level.
Some of the future players were at last weekend's U18 Sask First Camp. Rosetown's Paige Fisher wants to pursue the university route, but still considers the Junior League an exciting opportunity.
I think that's amazing. Like, I think too many girls whose minor hockey careers have already ended are sitting at home and, you know, who could have pursued playing hockey but couldn't due to having nowhere to go. And I think this league just opens up so many opportunities for these girls.
But before the puck drops in September, there's still a lot of work to be done. The commissioner expects aggressive recruiting as the new teams try to claim the top talent. Dan Plaster, CBC News, Regina.
And that is it for us tonight. For news anytime, you can head to our website or subscribe to CBC Saskatchewan's YouTube channel. We are back tomorrow at 5. Ethan's back tonight at 11. And up next, it's game one of the first round of the Stanley Cup playoffs between Tampa Bay and the Leafs. Enjoy the game.